Good morning, viewers. I welcome each one of you all to the live presentation of the day. Today, we are going to have an interactive session with the students on presentation techniques. To present this topic, we have Mr. Nagaraju, who is going to present this topic. I request Mallika ma'am to take the privilege to introduce our resource person today.
Good morning to everyone. I deem it a privilege to introduce our resource person of the day, Sri M. Nagaraju sir, MA, MED, PGDTE. Sir has taught English language and literature to graduate and postgraduate students at various colleges till he retired from the government service in the year 2012. Sir is a master trainer in communicative language teaching techniques certified by the US State Department English Language Fellow Program. Sir has organized more than 1000 training workshops for English lecturers. Sir has co-authored and edited 4 textbooks. Sir is a life member of Lions Club International and pioneered intraocular lens implantation surgical eye camps in rural areas and established a world record at a camp at Sarojini Devi Eye Hospital where 324 eye surgeries were performed on a single day and it was acknowledged by Guinness Book of World Records. Sir, we are very happy that you are in our midst today to guide our students and we welcome you to guide our students on the topic presentation techniques.
Thank you, Mallika. Thank you, Swarna. Yes. Thank you, Commissionerate, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Hello, everybody. I'm Nagaraju. So I'm going to lead this session now onwards for the next 2 hours. And this is going to be in 2 parts. Part one is going to be the what of the presentation. So what exactly are we going to present? How we are going to organize our ideas and a few other theoretical issues relating to the presentation techniques. And post break, we are going to have a second part of the session when we are going to discuss how we need to make presentations, how we have to make slides, and what care we need to take while making those slides. Okay, so are you all ready for the presentation?
Yes, sir.
That's really good. Before I begin, I just would like to give you a minute to think and recall any one good presentation that you saw anytime by anybody and also recall some not so very good presentations that you've seen till date and think of some features. Why do you think those presentations were very good or why do you think those presentations were not so very good? So, I'll give you a minute to think and then respond to me. Yeah, if you're ready, please, you can, any one of you can give some answers. You can tell me, yes, please.
Hi sir, my name is Naveen Nayak. I am from GDC Kukatpally.
Right.
I have actually seen a presentation by Steve Jobs regarding iPhone. So I actually liked it because it was very minimalistic and slides normally are filled with lot of text and all. But Steve Jobs' presentation was very minimalistic and
Thank you very much. Anybody else would like to say anything about a presentation that you've seen? Some good presentation or some bad presentation? Why was it good? Why was it bad?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, yes, please.
My name is Gopalakrishna. I once saw Gampa Nageswar Rao's motivational class. I thought it was very inspiring and it was a very good presentation about what students should think. So that inspired me. That's it, sir.
Good, good. Thank you. One more, please.
Sir, I have seen the presentation of
MP from Bengaluru South, that is Tejasvi Surya, and his presentation techniques and skills were really good, and the presentation of him is really inspiring, and he has a good technique to explain the things which he prepared to tell the people who are over there.
Excellent. Yes. Do you recall any bad presentation that you have seen? Anyone that needed improvement, anyone that was not really good, something went wrong for any reason? One answer at least.
Sir, yeah. I think my presentation was not so good, sir.
Your own presentation?
I need to improve myself.
Right, that's a very good comment about your own presentation. Thank you very much for saying that. In fact, I recall my own first presentation. So, I think I came to this very studio. This was about 15 years ago, I think. So, I was invited, I was chosen for making a presentation here, and then I came here. I was standing outside, the technology was not so very good those days. And remember, believe me, I was sweating profusely, I was absolutely nervous, and I made a mess of myself. And I thought I would make the presentation about 45 minutes, but it took me less than 30 minutes. I finished so very fast. And later, I had to search for things to cover during the rest of the time. So, everybody goes through that phase. In case you have to make presentations, and then if you are chosen by the commissionerate to make presentations to other students in your colleges, I think don't worry in case you are not very confident and if you are nervous. There is a first time for everybody, and I am sure every one of you will get over that fear and you will become master presenters very soon. So, I begin by wishing you all the best for the future presentations that you have been chosen to make. Okay. I think out of my experience, I have made some more than 50 lessons for Commissionerate of Collegiate Education, another 50 lessons for other organizations, some TV lessons for Intermediate Board also, but of them. So, when I look back and when I consider what are the things that make the presentation really, really good. So, I have formulated a principle of my own, and I think there are four principles. If you keep them in mind, your presentation will be absolutely thoroughly successful. What are they? So, if you see the screen, you will very easily remember them. I have made it an acronym for you, easy to remember, the ABCDs of good presentations. A stands for appearance, and B stands for body language, C stands for content, and D for delivery. We are going to maybe spend the first part of the presentation today, the first 50 minutes, on discussing these four things, what makes the presentation really good and what care do we need to take about each one of them. Let's just see. So, appearance. What do we mean when we say appearance? What does it include? It includes your dress, of course. Of course, you must be dressed appropriately for the occasion. Whenever you are going to make a presentation, take care of your dress. If your dress is not good, because people's attention, right, throughout your presentation, people's attention is going to be on your dress. First impressions are the best impressions. So, take care of your dress. What color and what comfort level. So, the dress that you wear when you go for a TV presentation must be thoroughly comfortable to you. The most important factor that you need to keep in your mind is comfort. How comfortable are you in that dress? So, more than looks of the dress, it is the comfort that's important. So, to ask yourself whether you are comfortable in that dress or not. Curtains, of course, are the best. And I mean, also dress yourself neatly, cleanly, well. But when I say appearance, I just do not have dress alone in my mind. I have lots of other things as well. Can you tell me what are a few other things that you need to keep in mind?
Eye contact.
Of course, eye contact is a part of body language. I am not coming to body language yet, but your appearance. So, for instance, how you groom your hair. Even small things, very small things like how your nails, sometimes the camera directly focus on your nails. Camera, I mean, there are some close-up shots. The camera comes very close to you at times. And even if you have not manicured, if you are not, if your nails are not clean, the camera catches even such small things. So, be very careful about every little thing, right? Not only just dress, and most importantly, your very presence must be pleasant. You must have a smile on your face, of course, and your whole presence must be such that students who are watching you from some distant college must be completely impressed by what they see on the screen more than what they are going to listen to you, because listening comes a little later. So your presence, your appearance is very, very important. Take care of that. So apart from your dress, apart from your cleanliness, apart from your hair, if in case you apply your lipstick, for instance, so if you apply too much lipstick, imagine. So if you are watching a program and then somebody is there on the screen and then too dark, too bright lipstick is applied, and then how do you feel if you are among the audience or among the spectators? The same way others also feel in case you don't look good. Other than that, maybe you can, in case you are wearing a tie, how you wear it. In case you are wearing a suit, how do you wear that? So how you wear your clothes also is not only the clothes themselves. Then take care of the colors of your clothes. Very recently, maybe about a few months ago, I saw a student presentation on TV, not this Nipuna TV, but some other TV. So he was wearing a very dark red shirt, and of course the color was okay, but it was too very bright and dazzling. So it was very difficult to listen to what he was saying. Our entire attention was focused on the color of the shirt and the dazzle. It was so very, because of the lights, no? So the color was so very dazzling. It was some kind of an eyesore. It was very distracting. So in case your colors are not appropriate to the occasion, audience's attention is lost. So students will not listen to you. So that's why take care of your appearance, and this is the first and the foremost thing that you have to keep in mind. So how do you do that? One easy way is you ask yourself in what colors you look good, in what dress you are comfortable, and then stand in front of a mirror before you come here or after you come to the studio also. Luckily, there is somebody who can help you. There is a mirror here, and then you can just stand in front of it for a minute and then ask yourself how you look good to yourself. And there are also people, your own teachers, for instance, they can help you what colors, what kinds of clothes you look good in. So take care of this. This is very, very important. So your content and your presentation skills and all that are extremely important, but your appearance also is important. So if you take care of that, one step you have already crossed, and then you are closer to making a very successful presentation. So are you all convinced about your appearance?
Yes.
That's really good. Right. So let's go on to the second one, A, B. So A stands for appearance and B stands for
body language.
So what does that body language mean? Any answers?
Gestures and postures.
Gestures, postures, and what else? So there are lots of things in this also, not only just gestures and postures, but you need to, I've given you another anagram, easy to remember, END MAP. Remember END MAP, to take care of your body language. So the first thing that you need to take care of is eye contact. Inside the studio, when you sit down to make a presentation, the only thing that you can make an eye contact with is the camera in front of you. So if you want to contact with the students who are sitting somewhere hundreds and thousands of miles away and they are watching your program, they cannot directly see you. They are not standing in front of them, but they are seeing the television. If you want to be seen television, if you want to be seen on television, and if you want to look as if you are directly looking into the eyes of your students, you must look into the camera. The camera is placed in front of you, and then you have to constantly look into the camera so that the students who are on the other side, in colleges somewhere far off, so they think that they are directly talking to them. So this is very important. This comes a little by practice. So practice looking in one single direction, maybe again into a mirror at your home, and then practice this. So talk to yourself, or maybe ask some of your friends to sit down in front of you and then talk to them. When you are talking to a class in real life, so maybe you can look here, you can look there, you can look on all sides, because the students are all over. So you can make what is called a global eye contact. You look around. But in a TV studio, so you do not have that facility, because there are no real students in front of you. You are speaking to the camera. So this is something that needs to be practiced. So please do it. Learn the art of looking straight into the camera and then speak. The second thing is, then gestures must be very natural. Usually young students who come to studios for making presentations for the first time, they have some very, very unnatural gestures. So they sit very tight, and then they don't know how to use their hands. They get stuck to a place, and then they don't use their limbs free, and they look very, very artificial. So again, this comes by practice, and you must practice this before you come to the studio. So try to use and use your arms, use your gestures absolutely freely. So when you are maybe in science subjects where there is not much to gesture, or maybe there are subjects where you need to just make the presentation, there is hardly any scope. But I think still, in case instead of sitting stiff and rigid, so if you are a little flexible, if you are free, and then if you make a presentation using the right gestures, your presentation will be much more perfect and much more impressive. The third thing is your posture. So there are two postures possible when you are making presentations. One, you can sit down as I am doing now, and you can sit down in a chair and facing the camera, and then you can make the entire lesson using, there is a keyboard in front of you, there is a system in front of you, there is a TV screen in front of you, and there is of course the camera, and then you can just sit down comfortably, and then sit in one single posture though, so that the cameraman does not have much difficulty in catching you, and then you can do that. The second possibility is you can stand up, and in case there is a board available, you can use the board and you can write on the board, but at the same time don't lose contact with the camera. Even if you stand and look at the board, you must be constantly looking into the camera and you must be presenting the lesson. So if you are standing, of course, you have a lot more freedom, but it has its own difficulties. If you are sitting, it has its own advantages, but disadvantages also are there. So choose which one do you like. There are some subjects which need the use of the blackboard while you are teaching. So you perhaps have to stand up. There are subjects that can be easily taught while comfortably sitting. In case you have a slideshow and if the slides are there to help you, perhaps sitting will be absolutely comfortable. So whether you are standing or sitting, your posture must be appropriate. So you must not recline, for instance, you must not sit too very relaxed, or if you are standing up, you must not look as if you are unenergetic, and then you stand quite energetically and then stand in a good posture and maybe choose the right place so that when you are speaking to the audience, they will connect with you. Then modulation and your volume. So how far the camera is, and of course, usually when you go to a studio for the first time, they'll ask you to test your volume, and then they ask you to say something so that they will check up your volume level, and then they will make some adjustments. Luckily, there is technology available. So if you speak in quite a low volume, they can increase the volume or they can reduce the volume and all that. But despite that, you must have the right volume. Just because technology is available, you cannot completely ignore that. You must still speak at the right volume so that it reaches there. If you speak too very soft, perhaps even technology cannot help you. Suppose you are standing up and you are holding a hand microphone. That's a little more difficult, because when you are holding a hand microphone, you need to know how far that should be held and then what care that needs to be taken. To put it very simply, instead of making a lesson about that, so always remember that when you are holding a hand microphone in your hand, there must be at least 3 inches of space between your mouth and your microphone. That's a ground rule. So if it's too very far, maybe it cannot catch your voice properly. If it is too very close, there'll be a resound, there'll be echo, there'll be squealing, squawking and all that. That's why, so be very careful. Modulate your voice. So if you speak in a monotony, if you speak in one tone, it will be too very boring for the audience. Within no time, I think the class gets completely, it will become too very lifeless. So modulate your voice. You must know when to increase the voice, when to decrease the voice, when to rise, when to fall. And if you modulate it, your attention, the attention of the listeners will be firm. So please learn to modulate your voice. Again, talking about different subjects that you are going to teach. Maybe you are teaching a mathematics lesson, you are teaching a physics lesson. There may not be a lot of scope to modulate, but still, within that limited opportunity, you can modulate so that your lesson becomes interesting. If you are teaching art subjects, if you are teaching language subjects, there is a great scope for you to do drama, some kind of drama on the screen. You can actually enact it. So you can make it so very lively that students will get glued to you while the lesson is going on. So please do that. Then active movement. Of course, if you are sitting, your movement is restricted. You sit in one place and do the entire lesson. But if you are standing up, there is a scope for you to move about. So you can move from one place to another. But at the same time, as I told you already, you have to constantly connect with the camera. You must be constantly looking into the camera, even when you are standing up and then moving about. So when you are moving about also, move quite energetically at the right pace. Let it not be too very fast and too very slow. So, your movement, your steps, let them be at the right pace. And finally, of course, very important as compared to the other things, you must have very pleasing manners. Maybe you get a question in between, or maybe you need to answer a question. Even if there are no question answers, even if there is no live interaction between you and your audience, you must still have very good pleasant manners, especially most importantly, a smile on your face. The smile must be natural, and then you, of course, it can be practiced. So, if you practice your lessons at home and then try this, you can certainly succeed in that. And then, so follow these things, ENDMAP, ENDMAP, keep these things in mind, and your body language is automatically taken care of. So, if your body language is good, your lesson is automatically much more impressive. So, take care of your appearance, and then take care of your
body.
What is the second one?
Body language.
So, your appearance is taken care of, some 25% of your lesson is done already, your body language is taken care of, another 25% of your lesson is taken care of, and what are a few other things, let's see. Of course, the most important purpose why you are here in the studio is to, why are you here? Why do you go to the studio? To deliver? A presentation, to make a presentation. So, this is the real purpose why you are there. So, though your body language and your appearance and other things add to what you are going to teach, this has no substitute. So, your content cannot be substituted with anything else. You must have the right content to deliver if you want to make a good lesson. So, whatever be subject. So, suppose you have come here to teach a lesson on statistics, or maybe computer science. So, you must do a lot of work to gather information and organize your information and do a lot of rehearsals, etc. before you come to the studio. This is something that happens much before you have come to the studio. Suppose you have lesson on the 1st September, perhaps this entire thing should be ready at least a week ahead. Your appearance, your body language are what happens when you are at the studio. Right on the day of your presentation, during your presentation. But content does not happen after you come to the studio. Content happens much before. Maybe you must start a month ahead. You must start as soon as you have decided your slot, as soon as you have decided your topic, as soon as you have talked to your principal, your teachers, your commissionerate and people responsible there. And then once you have identified, right, you have topic, and then you must begin preparing. So, this content has four parts: plan, prepare, practice, and present. Easy to remember, four P's. P1 is plan, P2 is prepare, P3 is practice, P4 is present. When you look at the arrows at the bottom, right, there are four arrows each leading to the next one, plan, prepare, and the third one, I have put a very large arrow there. I think you know why? Correct. That's all. So, that's the most important thing. So, the other things of course are important, but content is the most important thing. In case you come to a studio and then you want to make a presentation, suppose you do not have the right content or you do not have any content at all. The whole purpose is last. However attractive you look, however good you appear, however perfect your body language is and all other things are taken care of, but you have nothing to deliver. So, your lesson is wasted. So, at the end of the presentation, there must be some content, some take home for the students. So, the students must say, oh, yes, I have learned this today. So, what have you learned? So, these 1, 2, 3, 4 points that I have learned. So, in case they have to carry home those 4 points, perhaps you have to be extremely careful about what you are going to deliver, and that comes through these 4 steps. So, preparation. So, how does preparation happen? Out of the 4 P's, this is the first P. How do you prepare? Can you give me some answers to that? What are the various things that you do to prepare your lesson, or
gathering
before you prepare your lesson?
First.
Sorry?
Gathering the information first.
Right. Very good. Very good. Gathering information. Okay.
And, preparing it in a well-mannered form.
Uh-huh.
And making it into your points.
Perfect. Very good. But and before that, I would like you to do one more thing. You have given the right answer. But before you even begin doing that, I am just suggesting a very simple technique that helps you prepare for your presentation better. What is that? You must have a few questions answered. What are those questions? Question number one is, you must know the purpose of your presentation.
Yes.
Not all presentations are made for the same purpose. Sometimes you want to present a point of view, sometimes you want to discuss something, sometimes you just want to inform people. Sometimes you may make a presentation to inspire people, okay? Sometimes you want to make just a proposal so that it can be further discussed later. Sometimes you want to inspire people. So the purpose can be different. Of course, in the case of most of your presentations, you are likely to make some classroom-like presentations where the whole idea is to transfer information and to educate and equip your students with knowledge and skills. Most likely that's the purpose, but you must be very clear about that. So ask yourself this question, why am I making this presentation? So this is a lesson on maybe some plants in biology. So I'm going to talk about monophytes, and then what is this lesson? Why am I teaching this lesson? So what is it that I want to achieve? In other words, what are the objectives for my presentation? In fact, I would like to have a slide at the beginning. One of your slides at the beginning can be the statement of objectives. So these are the four things that I would like to have achieved by the time I finish this lesson. My students will have learnt these four things by the time the lesson is over. So if you have that clearly in mind, your lesson will go perfectly well, and at the end, once again, you can ask yourself, have I achieved my objectives? Right? Have my students learnt what I wanted them to learn? I think this is a great way of beginning your preparation. So ask yourself the purpose of your presentation. Another word for purpose is objectives. The reasons why you are making a presentation. Objectives usually are from the student's point of view. For instance, if you want to state a purpose, you can say, so I want to teach bryophytes is one objective. My students will have learnt about bryophytes is another objective. Which one do you think is better? I want to teach bryophytes is one. My students will have learnt about bryophytes is the second one. Which one is better?
Second.
The second one is always better. So look at it from the student's point of view and tell the students beforehand what they are expected to learn or what do you expect them to learn. I think this is one wonderful way of beginning any lesson. Please do that. Okay. The second one, know your audience. Of course, in your case, it's always graduate students. But within graduate students, sometimes there may be Telugu medium students, there may be English medium students, there may be rural students, there may be urban students, there may be students who have not done really very well in the past examinations. There may be some lessons which are exclusively meant for very bright students. I don't know what the commissionerate does and how it distinguishes, or maybe all lessons are for everybody. But in case tomorrow you become a teacher and then you want to go to a class and then you want to address them on a certain topic, so ask yourself, what are going to be the kind of your audience? Who are your students? So if you are teaching at intermediate level, you teach one thing, and then if you are teaching at graduate level, you are teaching a different thing. Maybe if you are teaching Telugu medium students, you have to pitch your lesson at a different level. Perhaps if you are teaching a different medium, your lesson will be pitched at a different level. So know your audience, right? So their gender, their social background, their medium of instruction, their ability levels. Right? Their expectations, most importantly, their expectations. What do they expect from you? So maybe if you have already done 2, 3, 4 lessons, and if you are going for the fifth lesson, their expectations will certainly be higher. Maybe when you go to make the first lesson, perhaps their expectations may not be very high. Of course, you can always outperform, you can do outstandingly well, but their expectations perhaps are not that good, that great. But once you advance and once you make a second lesson, I think some of you have already made lessons here, and then some of you are coming for the first time. So in case you want to make lessons like that, and then if you want to impress your audience, so know their expectations in advance, and then know them. Who are they? Whom are you going to address? The third thing that you need to answer, the third question that you need to answer is, what is the subject matter? Subject, I don't mean physics, chemistry, maths, not that subject. Subject means the focus area, the thrust area. So within that subject, what is the focus area? When you talk about the focus area, you must also talk about its scope. Scope means what is included, what is excluded. Today in my lesson, I want to do this. I want to do these 4 or 5 things. I don't want to do these 4 or 5 things. This is not within my scope today. And in case you make a statement about this at the beginning of your presentation, it will be extremely wonderful, because the students will know, oh, that's why this is not within the scope of this lesson. That's why it has not been covered. And if the students know, yes, I am going to be taught about this, they will be ready with whatever kinds of questions they need to ask, whatever kinds of understanding, etc., etc. So, define your scope. Maybe write it down. It's always a good idea to write down instead of just thinking and then leaving it there. So, take a piece of paper and then write down your objectives, write down the scope of your presentation, write your expectations and write the expectations of the students and begin preparing. So, if you begin like this, it will be very methodical. I think teachers also are always asked to prepare a lesson plan. So, I taught for a very long time. I know governments, departments expect us to prepare lesson plans, and the whole idea is the same thing. When I prepare a lesson plan, I know my objectives, right? I know the scope of my lesson. I know the tools that I am going to use. I know how much time I need to do each part of my lesson. So, the entire structure is in front of me when I prepare that lesson plan. That's the whole idea. So, a lesson plan is something that cannot be neglected. Same way, if you have some kind, not exactly that kind of a lesson plan that teachers do, but if you define these three or four things, it will come very handy and your lesson will be very successful. So, apart from this, you also should know how to organize your thoughts. Suppose you want to make 5, 10, 20 points during your lesson. Okay, you have done some research, like one of you said. So, you have done some research, you have gathered all the information, you have sat in the library, you collected some reference material, you have referred to some books and you have talked to your teachers, gathered a lot of information and entire information is now available. But do you just go and present it like that in one lump? I don't think. No, you should not do that. So, there must be a lot of care taken in organizing your ideas. Firstly, you must break your presentation into three parts. What are those three parts? One is the opening. Opening is the beginning, the introduction. Some people call it introduction. Then the main body of it, and of course, the conclusion or the closing or the ending of the lesson. So, it must be very clearly, it must be such that the student must be able to understand, oh, I am at this level. So, the opening is over. I am in the second part of the presentation. I am in the last part of the presentation. Even the audience or the spectators, your students must be able to see where you are. And how do you do that? So, opening is, when you make the opening, don't take too very long for that. Maybe 5 to 10% of the time that's available to you can be spent in the opening part of your presentation. I'll come to that in a later slide. I'll give you more details about that. And then similarly, the ending part of it, the conclusion part of it also, it's some kind of a restatement. What you said in your opening can be restated. Oh, they were my objectives and this is how I have achieved my objectives. Or I wanted you to understand this. Have you understood this? So, you can end with a question, for instance. Or you can summarize, you can revisit the points that you made. So, that is how you close. Maybe this also can take about 5 to 10% of the time that you have. But the remaining 50% of the time, or sorry, about 80-90% of the time goes to the body of your presentation. So, that 80-90% of the time, where does it go? Into making the points that you wanted to make. All those points must be perfectly structured, well connected, thoroughly organized, organically presented in a sequence. There are various kinds of sequencing. They can be chronologically sequenced, they can be logically sequenced, they can be thematically sequenced, they can be spatially sequenced. Choose whatever order you want, but organize them. So, for instance, if you are making the first point and you make the audience realize that you are at point number one, the second point must be automatically emerging from the first one, right? So, every point must automatically get connected to the previous one and must lead to the next one. So, if you are doing a science lesson, this is all the more important. If the points are not logically connected to each other and if they are strewn very loosely like that, I think the student, though you have made all the points, still the purpose is not met. The students have great difficulty in connecting them on their own. So, ask yourself, if I have 5 points to make, what is my first point? What is the second point and how is the second point connected to the first point? What is my third point and how is the third point connected to my second and first ones? And how is it leading to the fourth point, like that? So, put a kind of a structure, a skeleton of your points, of the thoughts that you want to present, okay? And after that, perhaps you can continue making the presentation. You can begin thinking about your presentation. Okay, so once you organized your presentation, you go to the studio and you need to make the first few opening remarks. When you are making the opening remarks, or maybe you are giving an introduction to it, one very interesting idea is, don't just do it very dry. I mean, let it not be a very dry way. Today I am going to talk to you about, I mean, this is quite a dry way of starting a lesson. Instead of that, I see even when I go to colleges and I conduct some competitions also, many students come, they have lots of good points to make, but their beginning is very bad. Usually they don't attract the students, they don't, they begin in dry in the sense, like the sentence that I just told, you know, so on the occasion of Independence Day, we have assembled here and I would like to talk to you about some such thing. This is a very dry way of starting it. What can you do instead? You can start either with an interesting story, right, a question, a very interesting anecdote, something that happened in the past and you can connect it to today, right, a very startling fact, something unbelievable, some facts. Do you know what happened in 1972? So you are recalling a past incident and connecting it to today. What is the largest, yes, in the world? So some such question you ask. So some facts you present before them and you connect it to the lesson that you are going to present. So do you know how computers work? So, and you are going to make a lesson about computers. So what is the, what do you know, what is inside a computer? Oh, maybe you know that there are some parts inside a computer. Perhaps you do not know that there is some very small chip inside that is the brain of the, so you build your lesson like that. Okay, so some startling facts, a biographical sketch. So maybe somebody who is very quite instrumental and related to the lesson that you are going to make. So you can begin with a biological sketch of the person about him whom you are going to make a presentation. Then any statistical detail, a proverb, a quotation, these are all various ways, but think of any one of them, not all. So think of any one of them which is relevant to the lesson that you are going to make and give the presentation appropriately. So for this you need to prepare. So during the time when you are preparing for the lesson, ask yourself, how can I make my presentation interesting during the first 1 or 2 minutes? One interesting way of looking at it is, maybe you have seen lots of Telugu, Hindi, English movies, whatever. So how is the hero introduced? How is the heroine introduced? The first scene. So the hero does not directly appear on the screen like that. Usually, so the director, the photographer, the director, the person who is in charge of that, no, they usually either show you the shoe of that person, or maybe the hand of that person, or maybe some beautiful aura is created so that the entry is always fantastic, right? So you are eagerly looking forward to that. So you know in the next few seconds it's going to happen, or sometimes you do not even know what's going to happen. So some thrill is there, some suspense is there, some astonishing, so some wonder is there. So anyway, so the entry is always very important. So your introduction is going to have a huge impact on the listeners. So the first 1 minute, 2 minutes is quite important. Today, for instance, when I began my presentation, I talked to you about my first presentation when I was very nervous. So similarly, you think of a story or think of an anecdote or a question or something that that makes the students feel interested in listening to you for the rest of the session. So use any one of these. Then closing, towards the end of it, when you are, before you close, maybe the last 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes, whatever. So whatever you stated during the entire presentation, you restate that very briefly. So this is the time for summarizing the ideas that you have presented. So make a summary of the 10 points that you made and then close the lesson. So summary of the entire presentation in a very short time and in 1 or 2 sentences is very essential, otherwise it will be very abrupt. I have seen some very good presentations that started abruptly. Suddenly the cameraman says, sir, you have only 2 minutes, you have only 1 minute, and the time is over. They say, okay, I have closed. and it looks very odd. So, ending the lesson abruptly also is a problem with young presenters. So, always plan your closing appropriately, summarize your ideas, and in case you started with a statement of objectives, if your one of your first slides was the list of the objects that you wanted to achieve, please show that slide again before the last slide, thank you slide, show that same slide a second time and tell them, oh, these are the objectives with which I started, hope I have achieved them, or I think this point 1, point 2, point 3, point 4 have been made. Right. So, if you connect the first slide with the last slide, the objective statement to the closing slide, I think it will be extremely good, because you are making a presentation and you are giving the objectives and you are ensuring that your objectives are met. That is a great idea. Then another way of closing a presentation is by leaving the students with a question. So, before I close this lesson, I have a challenge for you. Okay. So, think about it. And then find answers on your own. Maybe write to me or write to the commissioner, wherever, or maybe discuss. So, one step beyond the lesson that you have taught. It should be something more challenging than what you have already taught, or some way to apply what you have taught them. I have taught some points, I have made some points here in the class, and these points need to be applied in real life. So, give them a challenge, a puzzle, a question, and which cannot be immediately answered. Don't wait for an answer there, because the lesson is over now and the students are going to go home, and after that they are going to think about that and maybe they will explore a solution. They'll discuss and then find, evolve a solution for that question or challenge that you threw at them. So, please always think of something for the students to learn from your presentation and take it beyond. So, leave a question or a challenge, or like you began, you can also close with a quotation, and the quotation again should be relevant to the content that you have presented, and that is another way of closing a lesson. Whichever you have chosen to start your lesson with and whatever you have chosen to close your lesson with, they must be natural. For instance, just because a joke is good, don't take it to the class and then deliver that joke, because the joke is good, not related to it. So, again, I will come back to that a little later again, but maybe what I am trying to tell you is that always make it a point to identify something relevant, something appropriate to the occasion, something that is connected, something that makes your lesson more emphatic, more powerful, more impressive. So, choose that kind of ideas and begin your lesson with them and close your lesson with them. Okay. Regarding the content, the main body of the lesson, the middle of the lesson, as I told you already, this is going to be the most important part of it. The middle part of it is about 80-90% of the time, and you have to keep a certain guidelines in mind, and you have to make your lesson, first of all, very clear. So, when you want to present ideas to your students, all those ideas must be very clearly, very distinctly, very lucidly made, so that the students have no difficulty in understanding them. Put yourself in your own classes. Some regular teachers, your own lecturers have come to classes and then taught to you, and then if one idea you have not understood, how do you feel? So, if the teacher did not take the trouble of clarifying that idea to you, or did not take make it easy for you to understand, you will be go very disappointed. And the same thing is going to happen to you in case you do not clarify the ideas properly. So, what I suggest is choose less number of ideas, but throw enough light on them and make them very clear. Luckily, you have this technology, you have slideshows, you have visuals, and you have lots of other things that can support you. It is not very difficult these days. In the olden days, perhaps the only thing that was available to them was a lecture. Luckily, in case you have to, for instance, show the inside of a laptop, you can take a visual there, you can take a simulation there, you can take a whole animation there. So, that kind of technological tools are available, but the whole idea is to make whatever points you want to make thoroughly clear to you. The students should not have any further doubts beyond the class. And the second thing is language. So, if you are making the presentation in language, of course, your language must be good, but more important than being good, it must be very simple. Simplicity comes from simple words, right? Simple sentences and supportive details. So, when you some students usually I've seen some students like that, not many, but some, they use high sounding words. They think that if they use very difficult, long, high sounding, bombastic language, you know, they think they'll become more popular. It's not like that. Nobody likes someone using language that easily is not understood. I must speak language that is understood by everybody. The whole idea of communication is that, no? So, when I speak, if the other person does not understand me, what's the use? The whole purpose is lost. My speaking is wasted. So, when you make these presentations, I am sure you are going to practice your lessons, you are going to write them, try them at home, practice them and all that. But write them and add simple English language as possible. If it's not English, whatever language you are, if it's a Telugu lesson, okay, it's Telugu, but let the language be simple. Sentences also, they need not be long, winding, complex, and sometimes you begin here and then put a full stop after half an hour. So, that kind of sentences avoid. So, use simple sentences, right, and simple structures, and wherever necessary, give a clue, give support, supporting ideas, examples, etc., so that people understand you better, right. And finally, your organization also must be very simple, okay. So, make your organization so easy so that students can see structured lesson. So, let me move on to point number 2. Let me move on to the next point. After that, I would like to, suppose you say that, therefore, right, consequently, right, if you have understood my point number 1, shall we all move to point number 2? Suppose you use language like this. Automatically, the students know where you are, how your presentation is organized, how it is structured, and it will be very easy for you to move on. And finally, D. D stands for, as I told you, delivery. A was for appearance. B for
body
language. And C for
content.
And D for delivery. So, delivery is, of course, I made some of these points during the course of the previous points. I don't need to throw more light on them. So, the right loudness. So, you ask yourself, what is the right volume for your class? At what level it should be pitched? And if you use the right volume, your lesson is interesting. If you speak too very loud, it's a little offensive. Even in a classroom, you can call back, recall some classes that you had when some teachers or students who spoke, if they spoke very loud, I mean, it's a little distracting. Similarly, if they speak in whispers and the class does not understand what the whole purpose is last. So, speak at the right volume. Use the right intonation, ups and downs and highs and lows, volume changes, etc., etc. Your voice can be cultivated. Of course, you cannot become a Lata Mangeshkar all overnight, but you can certainly cultivate your voice. You can make your voice sound sweeter. It can be practiced. So, voice can be, there are courses on that. In fact, I very recently have seen a Google course that helps you cultivate your voice. I think excellent. Some of them are free, so you can try them. So, speak at the right pitch, right level, right volume, and you can improve the quality of your voice. Emphasis. So, emphasis is saying that something is important. So, if you put the emphasis in the right word, right? So, this is something I have never expressed, is different, expected, is different from, this is not what I expected. This is not what I expected. So, if the emphasis changes, the meaning changes. And finally, use pauses. So, when you are addressing students, for instance, I may be a little fast for a presentation like this because I have chosen my pace depending on two factors. One, I have more points for a 2-hour presentation, and two, I am speaking to the future presenters. So, that is why I chose a faster pace for my presentation. But maybe you can choose the right pace and the right pauses in between to make your presentations. So, we will take a short break here, and then when we come back, we will do the second part of the presentation. So, the 4 elements that make your presentation successful, we have considered, and let us see what care we need to take when we make presentation and then how we have to make our slides and present those details.
We request you all to please make a live call. If you have anything to ask, you can make a live call, and we also request you all to share your feedback on manatv.tgce@gmail.com, and that will be considered as your attendance. Please make a note of it. And now I request sir to continue with it.
Hello. Welcome back to the presentation. In the first part of the presentation, you saw how we need to plan our lessons, present our lessons, etc. So we looked at the content part of it. So how do we gather that information? How do we organize that information? How do we structure our presentation? How do we begin? How do I close? And all those things we have considered in the first part. Now let's move on to what care do we need to take to make our slides look better, how to make those presentations. So I think I don't need to discuss this slide with you, but maybe you can just take a look at it and see PowerPoint has many advantages. PowerPoint is a very, very useful technological app tool that's available to us, and I'm sure all of you are already using it. So in case you do not know how to use it, please learn it. It's not very difficult to learn, and you can learn it very easily and then make your slides and bring them here and then use them appropriately. But when you make slides, you need to keep some guidelines in mind. What are those guidelines? So let me present to you 6 guidelines today during the rest of my presentation. The 6 guidelines that I am going to discuss with you today are presented in the form of an anagram again. If you look at the first letters of those 6 points, what word do you make? What do the first letters of the 6 points make? Bullet. So BULLET. The 6 points that I am going to discuss today are: be simple, use highlighters or highlighting, use legible fonts, and use limited colors, and enrich whatever you are going to present on the slide with audio visuals, and finally make your text visible to the audience by using a technique called 6x6. So let's discuss each one of them in detail. So the first one, look at this slide itself. So what have I done? See, you saw this slide and the same slide with the same content. Yeah, I am showing it to you in a different format. What is the difference? Sorry? Any one of you, please. The first line is highlighted. What's the advantage in that?
People can view it.
So I'm drawing the attention of my students only to the first line, though in the previous slide I told the students there are 6 points that I would like to make. Now my focus is shifting to only point number 1. So what have I done? I highlighted line 1 and I subdued the color of the remaining 5 lines of the text so that students will understand, even if I don't tell them, that I am going to talk about how to make slides simple. So this is a very simple technique all of you can practice when you use slideshows. And also it is always a good idea to show the most prominent slide multiple times. So what am I going to do? You can guess now. I think, how many times do you think I am going to show this slide to you?
6 times.
6 times. So once in the beginning and 6 times again and again, I am going to say, show the same slide to you again and again with the emphasis shifting from one line to another, so that the 6 points that I'd like to make are reinforced again and again and again. So by the time the students leave the class, they will remember the 6 points that I have made. So this is a simple classroom technique that you can use by using some features like this. So we are going to talk about how to make our slides simple, how to make our presentation simple. Right. So making it simple happens during your presentation by just doing 3 things. What are the 3 things when I talk to you in the morning about how to organize your presentation? I told you that a lesson must be always organized in 3 parts. Do you remember the 3 parts? The opening, which was introduction, and the body, the main message, and the closing, right? These are the 3 parts of your presentation. Now the same 3, I am putting it in a different format now. So tell whatever you want to tell. That is my first part. So tell whatever you want to tell means you introduce your lesson. Tell. So your lesson begins by telling the students what you want to tell. So that means I am going to talk to you today about 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. My lesson is about, the point of discussion today is, the focus of my presentation today is, so you tell what you want to tell. Then the second part of your lesson, which is stated in one word, but it's like the longest part, tell. So do the lesson. 90% of the time you are doing this. So tell what you want to tell. After that, tell. So this is your lesson. The entire lesson, that 40 minutes, 30 minutes, whatever, this lesson is done here. And after the lesson is done, and tell what you have told. That is the conclusion. So the end part of it. So whatever you have told it in the previous 30, 40 minutes, you are going to retell. That is the third part of it. So if you just remember this sentence, it becomes very easy for you to structure your presentation and divide your presentation into three parts and make it as simple as it can be. So remember this simple piece of advice. Tell what you want to tell, part one. Tell, part two, the most important, and tell what you have told. That is after you have told what you wanted to tell. So these are the three parts, and this is how you can make your lesson very simple. Suppose your slides are like this. The previous slide, this slide is about the content, and this slide is about your slide. Suppose your slide is like this, right? Can students understand what you want to say? Usually, I have seen quite a lot of presentations. I have been asked to evaluate presentations made by students. In fact, very recently, I went to a certain organization where some hundreds of students were asked to make TV presentations like you are going to do, and I was asked to evaluate them and give them feedback. Many of the slides that I saw made by students were like this. So too much of information presented on the slide. So that makes it, impossible for anybody to understand them. So in case your slide is like this, right, you need to take enormous care to see that a lot of junk is removed from that and the least possible text is presented on the slide and the slide is impressive to look at. And minimum text, maximum effect. When you are traveling, minimum luggage is maximum comfort. When you are presenting, minimum text is maximum effect. So keep that in mind, make your slides very simple. Okay. What is the second point?
Excuse me, sir.
Use highlighters. So this slide itself is an example of how to highlight something. Want to highlight something, there are many different ways it can be done. So there are quite a lot of different ways. So I don't know if it works here. This animation is not working here, I think, but it's working. So suppose you have a slide like this with text. How is the text there? Too much of text, of course, but more important than the text, right? You have a question? Yeah, please go ahead.
Excuse me, sir. My name is Sriharini Basavaraju and I'm studying BSc MScS in Government Degree College for Women, Begumpet, and have a question, sir. Sir, as we discussed about the preparation for the presentation, so how well is it necessary to make a rough flow chart of the content which we are going to give presentation on?
It is very important. Thank you very much for highlighting that point. In fact, that's exactly what I told you when I talked to you about organizing your presentation. You must have a flow chart. I asked you to take a rough sheet of paper and then work on the number of points that you would like to make and organize. So there must be a clear flow that can be seen. Your first point, as I told you, should be connected to the second point, and the connector also must be seen. It must be very visible to your students, or it must be clearly heard by your students. So if there are 10 points that you are going to make, each one of them, one to the second one, the second to the third to the fourth one, must be thoroughly connected. That's what's flow. So if you prepare a flow chart, nothing like that. I think if you are a student of computers, or if you are a student of some technical subjects like that, you know what a flow chart is. And if you prepare a flow chart from where you are going where and by what route and how and why, I think that makes a great lesson. Thank you for making that point. It's a good idea. Okay, coming back to the second point of the second suggestion that I wanted to give you, in case you want to present some text like this. So instead of presenting some running text like that, you can just use various ways of different techniques of highlighting your text. So you can make it bold, you can underline it, you can put it in italics, you can change the color of that text, you can size, change the font of that. There are 100 different ways of doing it. Luckily, technology allows that. So use all the technology that's available, and even if you have one line of text, within that one line, if there is one word that's very important, highlight that so that the focus of the students is drawn to that. In case a student does not read the whole sentence or the whole paragraph, and if you help him identify the most important part of that sentence or that paragraph, it is very easy for him to understand that and follow that. In fact, those who read books fast also follow this technique. They read texts in chunks. In fact, many good readers don't read the whole text line by line, word by word, etc. So they read, instead of reading horizontally, they read vertically. They read page by page, not line by line. So they just see, and then they can focus their attention automatically to some important highlighted points, and then they can move and they can understand and grasp things easier. So, if you know how to highlight the text, it's a great advantage, and then it's a benefit not for you alone, it is a benefit for the viewers also. The viewers will follow you very easy. So, learn to highlight, use anyone, don't use all these techniques that I'm showing you on this slide. So, within the one slide, if you use all these techniques again, it looks very odd. So, use any one of them, any one of whatever is your favorite. For instance, if you change the color of the font, that's enough. So, if there are three words that are very important on that slide, and if those three words are in a different color, that's enough. Okay? So, use any one of these highlighters. The third one, use always legible fonts. So, there are hundreds and thousands of fonts available to us in Microsoft as you use your slideshow, or as you prepare your slideshow. But some fonts are for some fancy purposes. So, for instance, those kinds of italics, and I'm not able to recall some names of those fonts, but some fonts are, I mean, they cannot easily be read on the screen. So, it will be difficult for the readers have to strain their eyes to read some fonts, right? Scripts, for instance, any kind of script is not easy to follow on a screen like this. So, you can talk to some teachers in your college and then ask them what fonts are the best. In fact, TV presenters have their own suggestions. Only some fonts are appropriate for occasions like this. Use those fonts and see. In fact, you can go through a test for yourself. Yes, right. So, the legible fonts, identify them and then use them. And don't use too many fonts, I'll come to that. So, for instance, take a look at this slide. Actually, this is just three lines, and the message is very simple. It's not very difficult to follow. The fonts are large, they are readable, but still, what's the problem there? Too many fonts. Every word is written a different font. What are you trying to achieve through this? Just because PowerPoint allows you this, don't use too many fonts. So, you are actually making a mockery of that. It looks a comic piece. It looks a joke to me, this slide. So, if you have too many fonts on the slide, no? So, it is distracting. So, maybe the students are counting the number of fonts instead of following the content of that slide. So, avoid that. So, the best slides are like this, maximum two fonts. Don't use more than two fonts in a slide. Remember this is a golden rule, maximum two. I am talking about academic slides. I am not talking about slides that are intended for entertainment. So, if you are going to make a presentation that is intended to entertain audience, or if you want your audience's attention riveted on some effect, perhaps that's a different focus, that's a different objective. There you may use 1,000 fonts. I don't know why, for what purpose, but you may do that. But here, in academic presentations, don't use more than two fonts on a slide. At best, two fonts for the text and maybe one more font for the title or the heading. But I think a third one, if it's better if you avoid that, entire title in one font, entire text in one font is ideal. Of course, you can highlight some words within that font using.
Question from the student.
Yeah, please. Yes, please.
Sir, my name is Pradeep Kumar, sir.
Okay.
I am from BJRGDC, Narayanguda.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, while presenting the theoretical lessons, how to connect with the students, sir?
While making a theoretical presentation.
Yes.
Yeah, even when you are making a theoretical presentation, you are supported by your slides, you are supported by your audio visuals, you are supported by simulations or whatever. And then once you have that supporting material with you ready, of course, you are reinforcing the concepts that you would like to, drive home. And the second thing is, in case you have a concept which does not have any audio visual support and it can only be taught, it cannot be demonstrated, you have to go slow, you have to use simple language, you have to say it a second time, and you have to put it in the form of a question. After you made the point, you have to ask your students to respond so that you can check whether they have comprehended it or not. There are what are called comprehension check questions, not just questions which check factual knowledge. For instance, if I show this slide to you and ask you this question, how many fonts are ideal for a slide? And the answer is 2. Whoever says 2, the answer is correct. And it's not difficult to answer. That's not a concept check question. That's a factual question. Factual questions are useless. Maybe at a primary level, at a high school level, perhaps they are okay. But if you are talking to graduate students and if you want to check whether the students have understood it or not, you must change the question. Instead of asking how many fonts are good for a slide, for instance, if I change the question and say, why do you think only 2 fonts are good on a slide? So they have to begin thinking now. So they have to begin thinking and they have to give their own answer. And each one can answer a different way. So if there are 20 students in your class, 20 answers are possible. Or at least if you ask, do you agree with me? Or if you think, do you also think that 2 fonts is good, or do you think more fonts are okay? Suppose at least you are generating a debate there, right? Maybe some students agree with you, some students say, no, sir, I think 5 fonts are okay. No, sir, I think 2-3 fonts are okay. I think only 1 font is good. So there is a debate possible. So if you ask concept questions, concept check questions like that, or if you encourage a debate or a discussion in your class, automatically even theory subjects also can be taught extremely well. So the whole focus must be in any lesson, whether it's a TV lesson or a regular lesson, it must be made student-centered. As long as the teacher is delivering the lesson without any interaction, without any question, without any student-centric focus, the lesson is just delivered. Today, the focus is shifting from teaching to learning. This is something that you must, always keep at the top of your mind. Shift the focus from teaching to learning. Have the students understood what you have said? That's important. So, for that, if it's a theory subject, if there is no support of audio visuals, make your class interactive, go slow, repeat what you say, ask questions, get answers, right? Have some concept check questions, etc. Hope I have clarified your point. Okay, right. Yes, please.
When it comes to a formal presentation, is it really necessary to face the people completely in the entire presentation, or is it necessary to look at the presentation which is going back of us, or what the things we must take care of while presenting a PowerPoint presentation mainly?
Yeah, there are actually 2 questions in your question. The answer to your question depends on where you are making this presentation. If you are making a real life presentation with real students in front of you in a live classroom, you must look at every one of your students. There is something called a global eye contact. Global eye contact means no student in your class must feel left out. If there are 20 students in my class and if there are 10 of them sitting here and 10 of them sitting here, I am looking at them, I am looking at every one of my students in the class so that they connect with me. But in a studio situation, it is completely different. In a studio situation, you don't have students in front of you actually. The students are not there. The students are somewhere else, or maybe you don't know whether they are there at all. All TVs perhaps are shut down now. You are making a presentation in the night, which will be telecast tomorrow. And you know for sure not even one single student is watching you. All that you have in front of you is a camera. Then there is no other way you can contact with your students except looking into the camera, and constantly looking into the camera is the only way. But at the same time, even here, when you are looking into the camera, suppose I sit like this and I'm looking into the camera and speaking like this. How will I look? So it look a stare. It look a stare, not looking into the camera. So my focus is on just one point there, and I'm straining my eyes and I'm looking into the camera. Like that look very odd. So even when I'm looking into the camera, I must be very natural, isn't it? Even within that four corners of the camera, I have a lot of space actually. So when I'm looking all over the camera, the students who are on the other side of the camera are in front of the TV, they feel I am looking on all sides, isn't it? So this is a technique that comes by practice. So I am looking at the camera, but the student does not know that I am looking at the camera. If I look straight, the student thinks that I am looking at his eyes, looking into his eyes. And when I move my eyes within the scope of that camera, students feel that I am looking everywhere. Okay? Right. So that is about the fonts. Then, you have another question?
Good morning, sir. This is Firdos Tabassum of IPGTCW.
I cannot hear you. Will you please speak a little louder, please?
Okay. Good morning, sir. This is Firdos Tabassum of IPGTCW, Nampally. My question is, each slide should contain how many lines?
Yeah, I'm coming to that. Maybe please wait for another two or three slides. I'll tell you. Yes. Okay. Any other questions? Right. So let's move on. Is there one more question?
Yes, sir. Sir, generally in presentation, we will have some stress. So how to get relieved of that stress, sir?
Okay, that's a good question, but not within the scope of my presentation today. But still, because you have asked me that question, I just would like to tell you, build your confidence, right? Get used to it, practice. So if you do two or three practice presentations at home before you come to the studio, you can overcome your stress. The best idea is gather some friends of yours, offer them a cup of tea, right? Give them a chocolate and then call them home and make them sit around and then give the entire presentation to them. So because they have sat half an hour with you and have given you some useful feedback, you owe them a party, right? So spend a little money, or maybe you can ask your father, brother, sister, whoever is available at home, ask them to sit down in front of you and make presentations beforehand. So that gives you a lot of confidence. Once you have made a full length presentation beforehand, I think your confidence level will be doubled. If even that is not possible, right, stand in front of a full length camera, a full length mirror, and then make the presentation. I think even that is good. But practice is, though, no substitute for practice. Even I know some very senior, very expert, very seasoned trainers, presenters also practice before they come to classes like this. So it's, in fact, do you think I'm just coming here and then making this presentation? This very slideshow tells you that I prepared. So my lesson is ready. Otherwise, I would not have been able to come here and make this presentation. So I prepared. So preparation is absolutely essential, and preparation gives you confidence. And there are confidence building techniques that will be a complete different lesson. Maybe you can take a lesson on that, or you can help yourself. Self-confidence is the best, of course. So build your confidence so that you can overcome your stress. Right? Right. Shall we move on? Is there one more question? Yeah. Yes, the last one.
Sir, I'm Kruti from GDC Kukatpally.
I can't hear you, please.
I'm Kruti from GDC Kukatpally, and my question to you is, like, how do we reconnect with the listeners after a pause, and the pause can be due to technical error or nervousness?
You mean different kinds of pauses?
Like, how do you reconnect with the listeners, like, if there is a pause in between?
The pauses should not be that long. When I say pause, it does not mean you stop here and start tomorrow. That's not a pause. A pause means a time to take a breath. So when you are making a presentation, so if there is some visible, perceptible, a part of a second, a split second, is the pause in between one sentence and another. So the whole idea of a pause is that your listeners must understand that this is not an overflowing sentence. The sentence has ended here. There is a comma here. There is a colon here. There is a question mark here. So if they understand that, that's the pause that you get. Right? So pauses are not too very long. Pauses are brief, and they indicate that, like, when you write, so the full stop tells them that the sentence is ended and the new sentence has begun. When you speak, that facility is not there. So that facility is substituted by your pause. Your pause is a full stop. Your pause is a question mark. Your pause is a comma, etc. So use that pause, that kind of pauses. Okay, I told you about maximum two colors, and the next point is, sorry, yeah, this we have seen, no? So two colors, yes, not too many colors. Then enrich your presentation with as many, and of course as many means not too many, but enough audio visuals. Luckily again, there are hundreds and thousands of audio visuals available on any subject that you search on the web. Go to Google Images or Google and then search for whatever you look for. There are lots of visuals available to you. But remember, some of these visuals are copyrighted. So in case they are huge, if you use the whole of them as they are without any changes, and if you just extract them and then pull them out of the web and then keep them, you can sometimes land into trouble, legal trouble. So that's why take care. So just check whether it's copyrighted or not. If it is copyrighted, avoid using it at your level. There are so many uncopyright, non-copyright visuals also possible. So use them, it's always a good idea, no? So simple visuals. Visuals need not be very highly elaborate and then two very ornate things, but they can be simple affairs which are available readily for download and use them. Okay, so some simple visuals like this. There are things like, for instance, charts, there are pictures, there are animations, there are clips, short clips, there are very short video bits. So you can use any of them to make your presentation a little more appealing to the eye and more convincing to the audience, and also it helps you make your points clearer. So what do? You use objects, charts or videos or slideshows or whatever. And when you show a video, I have seen some students, again this is another problem with them. So what they do is they have a visual, a beautiful appropriate visual, they show it only for 1 second, half a second, and then they move on to the next slide. So the purpose is lost again. So if you don't give enough time to your listener, is there a question about this? Yeah, please go ahead.
Myself Supriya from BJR College, sir. Sir, I had a doubt that if the description is too long, so make it, so how to make the students to get it clear, detailed understanding through pictures, we can make them to understand, sir?
Yes, of course you can do that. If the concept is difficult to understand, if the concept is complex, so you can always split that idea into multiple slides and you can use appropriate visuals. Visuals make things easier to understand, simple, right.
At some point in time, we'll face a situation to give an instant presentation. So what are the tips you would like to suggest us at for that instance of time to give an instant presentation?
Instant presentations, instant issues can have only instant solutions. So if the problem is instant, the solution cannot be made before. No. So we don't know what kind of problems are. For instance, did I expect your question now? No. So in case I want to give you an answer, I must have a solution now. So you cannot premeditate them. However well you prepare, there are bound to be some unexpected situations, and you need to have the common sense, presence of mind and experience, three things. So you need common sense, you need presence of mind, and you need a little experience. So with experience comes how to handle situations. Of course you can, there is nothing wrong. I think there is a good point that you made. In case there is a situation when you do not know the answer, the most appropriate way of handling that situation is, I am sorry, I don't know the answer to that, I'll check it up and get back to you. Is there anything wrong in that? There is no rule that the presenter must know everything. So if I have come here and if I don't know answers to 5 questions that I'm asked now, what's wrong in that? I may know answers to 5,000 things and the question that you ask perhaps is not known to me. And there's no point in frankly accepting that, I'm sorry, I've never come across this issue or I've never thought about this problem. Thank you very much for saying that. Oh, that's a great idea. That's a good question. And you have made me think. Right? Oh, this is something, some area where I need to do some research. So maybe please call me later. Please meet me outside the class. Some solutions like that are always possible. And being frank is always a positive strength in your favor. And because this point has come, though it may be out of place, I would like to tell you, this is especially important in case you are going for an interview. In interviews, if you say that you don't know an answer, I mean, then there is nothing wrong in that. So there is a call from somewhere, I think. Yes. Please put it on. Hello. Hello.
Hello, sir.
Yeah. Yes, please.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, my name is V.R. Krishna. I am from Degree SR College, Karimnagar.
Yeah.
Sir, my doubt is how to manage the time, sir, while saying in a theoretical class, for a topic of mathematics, how can we manage the time saying on board or seeing the slides or seeing the camera?
That's a good question, Krishna. Thank you for asking. Time management is very easy if you plan your lesson well, if you rehearse your lesson well. In fact, I told you that you must have something like a lesson plan. In case you are preparing a plan, you must write against each point, I am going to spend 2 minutes for this, 3 minutes for this, 1.5 minutes for this. I want to spend whole 10 minutes on this discussion. I am expecting 4 questions at this point. So, in case you plan your time like that, the chances of going out of time are having time left over is not, I mean, possible. But in case you do not plan at all, if you just go and if you think, in fact, I told you my own personal experience. So, when I did my first lesson, what happened? I finished everything that I wanted to say. I had some 20-30 slides and I finished them in maybe 20 minutes ahead, and then I had great difficulty in spending the remaining time. So, that should not happen. It comes with experience again and it comes with planning. So, if you plan how much time you want to spend on each part of it, right? You can manage your time well. Good question. Thank you.
Sir, yeah. How many slides are recommended for a 45-minute show?
I personally think that 10 to 15 slides for an experienced faculty, experienced trainer should be enough. But if you are a beginner, you can have more slides.
And how many pictures are recommended in one slide?
No,
sir?
No need. There is no minimum, maximum necessary. It should depend on the content. There are topics which may not need any visual support. There may be topics which need a lot of visual support, and visual support, if it's available, use it.
Thank you, sir. So
okay. Yes.
How to make presentation effective?
How to make presentation?
Effective.
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 So, this entire presentation is on that, no? So, this entire 2 hours that we are spending is on how to make our presentation effective. So, every one of the tips that I am trying to give you is a tool that will help you if you follow it. So, it is going to help you to make it effective. Okay. So, coming to visuals. So, use visuals, but use them properly. And one problem that happens when young presenters, those who do not have enough experience, is when they are presenting a visual, especially if it is on the board in a real classroom situation, they turn to the board, they turn to the visual and lose touch with the students. So, this is, I mean, very, very, this can turn a very highly disadvantageous. So, that is why even when you have the visual, you must know what is there on the visual at the back of you. You are not looking at the screen actually, the screen is at your back. So, you are looking in front of you and you are talking about the visual. So, that is again, it comes with experience, you must practice that and do it. Oh, there is a call, it seems. Yes, please.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
I am from SR Government College, mm-hmm. Karimnagar. I am Sheshidhar.
Yes, Sheshidhar.
And my question is there a provision for using any models in the interactive session?
Yes.
Like, apart from using board and slides, can we use models to demonstrate the topic?
Yes, excellent question. You must carry a model with you if possible.
Yes, sir.
For instance, I am talking about glass, and then if I take a real glass to the class and I show them a glass, nothing like that. Technically, it is called realia, R-E-A-L-I-A. Realia is always a great idea. So, carry some realia with you, especially if you are a science teacher, and if you can take a model, a design,
for chemistry,
an actual
model,
object.
For showing a detailed structure of a compound, I need to carry a model.
Please do it. Please do it, that will be a good lesson. There are things that can be carried inside the class, you can do them. For instance, if you want to speak about aeroplanes, you cannot bring a real aeroplane into the class, but you can take a model aeroplane. You can take a sample aeroplane. If you want to talk about an elephant, you cannot bring it to the class, but an elephant, I mean either a toy elephant or a visual of it or an animation of it is always a great idea. Please do it. Use it. Yeah, yes. Thank you. And then moving on to the next one. So, too much of visuals, too many visuals also is a problem. So, some students think that every slide must have some visual, every slide must have an overload of visuals, and that again spoils your lesson. So, you cannot give enough attention to each one of the visuals that you have chosen, and you will have great difficulty in managing finishing the lesson in time. That is why. So, avoid too many visuals, that is another problem. This I think you know already. A lesson supported by visuals can be retained much, much longer. Look at the last graph. So, in case you make your presentation audio plus visual, right, oral, visual, etc. So, you have your presentation supported by visuals. So, the retention is extremely high. It is more than 3-4 times higher. So, that is why I always make your presentations audio, visual, whenever, wherever possible to the relevant extent. And the last slide. So, one of you asked me a question about how many lines of text is good on a slide, and this is my last tip today. So, there is a rule called 6x6. 6x6 is something that every one of you must remember, whatever subject slides you are making. So, what is this rule? So, from visibility point of view, from lucidity point of view, from legibility point of view. So, it is easy if you have not more than 6 lines of text on a slide. So, if you recall all the slides that I have shown you today so far, none of the slides has exceeded this limit. So, you can go back and then see these slides. I will give the slideshow to you. So, I have deliberately kept in mind, and then I have made all my slides follow this rule. So, no slide will have more than 6 lines. What is that 6x6 then? So, no line will have more than 6 words. So, 6 words to a line and 6 lines to a slide is the limit. What limit? The limit is from the point of visibility, clarity, right? So, ease, comfort. So, because your students might be sitting inside those halls in your colleges at different distances. So, the screen is usually on one of the walls, and usually some of these halls are very long, and students sitting at the back also must be able to see the screen clearly. So, your TV screen, maybe a 50-inch, 60-inch television is all that you have in your college, and with that kind of television, students sitting at the back will not be able to follow what you write on the slide if it is more than 6 lines. This is not what I am telling you, this is a scientific fact that has been established by researchers on how visible things are from what distance. So, follow this 6x6 rule, all slides must be must follow this rule. There is a call, it seems. Hello. Hello.
Hello, Namaskaram, sir.
Yes.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, from DDC Gadwal, BA Sarsen, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, my question is, what should be the duration of a clip, audio or visual? Hello, sir.
Yeah, I understand. So, how long should a visual be shown on the screen is your question. So, it depends on what kind of a visual it is. So, if the visual is easy to understand, maybe 5 to 6 seconds should be enough. But if the visual is a little difficult, and then if you have some labeling on that, and if the visual is complex, it needs time to interpret, perhaps you are taking time to describe the parts of that visual, it can be any long. Maybe I know lessons that can be done with one single visual entire class. Look back, I don't know if what subject you are studying. Suppose you are a zoology student and your teacher brings one visual to the class. At least in the olden days, we used to have charts. Our lecturer used to bring one chart to the class and he used to display it. An entire 1 hour class used to be done with that one visual, because there was so much in that text, in that visual, in that chart. So, he used to put it on the wall and he used to explain all the parts of that, and then that was the class. So, there is no fixed time limit for showing visuals. So, you must decide, you are the judge. So, if you are showing a visual, you must ask yourself, why am I showing this, and how long should I show it so that my students can understand it. So, it's a visual based, specific to the visual that you have chosen. Okay. How is this slide? How is this? Look at the previous one, 6x6, and how is this slide? Too much of text, maybe 10-15 lines. Suppose you prepare your slides like this and then you take them to the class or you take them to the studio and you show them, and if you turn them like this, what is the use? In fact, the whole purpose of preparing a slide is completely lost. You do not know why PowerPoint slides are made and then what your presentation is on. Never. This is an extremely bad slide, right? It's an extremely bad slide, and such slides must be avoided at all costs. As if it were not enough, some students prepare slide like this. The slide flows on from the previous slide, right? So one slide is not enough for them. So continuing the second slide also, the paragraph runs on. So by at all costs, please avoid slides like this. So your slides must look like this, right? So take enormous care if necessary. Break your slides into multiple slides, but don't jam them with too much of text. It will be like Hyderabad roads, right? Too crowded, you cannot move about at all. What's the use, right? Okay. These are some more tips before we close the class. So don't just read. So I have seen many students doing this. They take slides to the studio and they keep on reading it line by line. So in fact, anybody sitting in front of the TV can easily understand. Oh, you are reading it. So your eyes are moving like this, right? So from left to right, left to right, left to right. So within that slide, if you are reading it like that, I think you are that's a bad presentation. So please don't just read the slides. Explain the slides. The slides are very helpful tools, very helpful supports. They are aids. So they are there as some kind of a prop, support you. So use that support, but explain. If you just read, there's no point. So they can go home and read the slides. They don't need to sit in front of the TV at all. So pause, reinforce, and this is a tip about Microsoft PowerPoint. In case you want to add something to every one of the slides, you can go to Slide Master. There is something called a Slide Master, and if you go to Slide Master and edit it, whatever you have edited there applies to all the slides. For instance, I have added my name just to demonstrate how you can add it. So I don't need to add my name to each one of the slides. So the name automatically appears on all the slides. Suppose you are making a presentation and you want to connect with your audience, and you don't want your audience to keep looking at the slide. You want them to look at you. So you can press the button B, for instance. So if you press the button B on your screen, on your keyboard, automatically the screen goes blank. The screen goes blank, it becomes dark, and then the students cannot see what's on the screen, they must see you. When you've finished speaking to them, you can again press the letter B on your keyboard, and again the screen is there in front of you. So use some tips like that so that your presentation becomes easier. So use the Slide Master, use that letter B, and use the right pace. And there are likely to be some glitches somewhere, some technical problems are likely to be there. Your slideshow does not open, your pen drive has some virus, or maybe in real life situations, many times I have faced it, there is no power where you go and the power fails in the middle, or the system does not work, it does not boot. Some such thing happens. Be prepared for that, right? So this is about it. So these are some very bad slides, not because you do not know the subject, not because of other reasons, but because you have not taken care to present them properly, too much of text, too small fonts. And in fact, for instance, if you have a slide like this, what can you tell me? Suppose you have a slide like this, what can you do? Anybody? How can you make this slide better?
Decreasing the number of lines.
That's all. Increasing the number. Suppose you increase, already increase, no?
Decrease
the number of slides. That means, but suppose suppose this information is important, how can I decrease it? Suppose all this information is important.
We can split the lines. That's all. Into very next simple. Slide.
So split that into 2 slides, 3 slides, 5 slides if necessary. So make more slides if necessary, but make them quite visible so that students can easily read that and students can easily follow. Right.
So I have a question, sir.
Yes.
My name is Pavya. I'm from GDCW Begumpet. The question is, we have seen individual presentation techniques right till now. I want to know what are the suggestions for pair presentation, because each of in a pair has different opinions for a particular subject. So,
pair presentations, group presentations, team presentations can be made in different ways, and depending on your comfort level, depending upon the practice that you have already done, it can be presented multiple ways. One easy way is you make the first 15 minutes and then she makes the next 15 minutes. So, that is pair presentation, two separate presentations actually. So, merged together. If both of you are making the presentation together, you must rehearse it. So, which points you are going to make, which points your partner is going to make. So, if there is very good understanding between you, it will be very easy. You can even have an anchor between you. So, there are two of you making the presentation, there is one anchor from your college, another student, a third student who comes and assists you. You give the question. So, you prepare a list of 15 questions, for instance. So, your question number one, he poses to the one on the right, the one on the left. So, it can be done like that. It can be open. Suppose you are quite experienced, you know how to do it, you know how to stop each other and how to intervene without hurting the other person. So, like it happens in group discussion, it can be an open presentation, you know how to share. And any 5 minutes before, 6 minutes before, you are given a sign and then you have to begin concluding, and that's how you can close. So, there are many different ways. Success depends on your practice, your comfort, your experience, your practice. Okay?
So I have also another question, sir. You already informed us when certain visuals are presented, we can look at the back. But certain visuals like diagrams in biological sciences need to be pointed out for certain explanations, sir. So, how can we do it when
I know this question is difficult to answer, but the thing is there is some technique called a 45 degrees angle in the class. So, maybe if I am standing, I can demonstrate that. I have a collar microphone here, I cannot move from here. But what happens is there is, suppose this is the wall and then you are standing here. Instead of standing at 180 degrees, showing your back to the students, learn to stand at 45 degrees angle like this. That means half of your body is turned to the board and half of your body is turned to the students, and then whenever necessary, occasionally every half a minute, every few seconds, you can turn to your back and then you can keep in touch with the students. Okay, so let's move on. So, there are a few things that you should not do. These are, I think, indirectly and directly we have discussed them. The most important, then, some boys have the habit of, if they are standing and making presentations, they put their hands in their pockets. That is losing their hands during the presentation. Please don't do it. You keep your hands open and then use your hands quite comfortably, freely, so that your presentations become quite lively. So, that is where we stop. So, practice is the only golden principle that I can give you. The more you practice, the more successful you are. The more you practice, you are assuring yourself of success when you make the presentation. I wish you all the best. If you want to see this presentation again, there are two websites on which I have loaded it already, authorstream.com and slideshare.net. You can use those two web links to see the slideshow and also follow those tips. So, thank you very much. Wish you all the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for coming and giving us this opportunity to be a part of this interactive session. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Wonderful having you here.